Let's talk about blaxploitation. For those unfamiliar, it's a term given to the spike in films in the early to late 70s made by and for an African-American audience. Some of the films that get lumped into this subgenre are legit films, like Sweet Sweetback's Badass Song, The Mac, and even Superfly. But true blaxploitation to me is when low-budget films try to cash in on this trend with parodies and rip-offs of mainstream films starring predominantly an African-American cast, usually with the word black right in their title. Black Samson, Black Samurai, Dr. Black and Mr. Hyde. Yes, actual movie title. And my personal favorite, which I've reviewed on this show, Blackula. Speaking of Blackula, obviously this was an African-American version of Dracula. And for what it is, it's pretty well done. But someone took the monster parody even further than that in 1973 when someone squeezed out a steaming corn log called Blackenstein. Blackenstein, aka the Black Frankenstein. Can you imagine if this borderline racist trend still existed today? You'd end up with movies like The Black Avengers or Broke Black Mountain. Anyway, Blackenstein takes place in the present day in this creepy mansion castle-looking thing where it's constantly storming because thunderstorms are scary. Quick aside here, if the monster in this movie is ever actually referred to as Blackenstein, I will riot faster than if Walking Dead killed off Daryl Dixon. We see this woman take forever and a day to get to the castle where she meets an awkward man named Malcolm who answers the door.
Yes?
Is Dr. Stein in?
Yes, he is. Do you have an appointment?
No,
Dr. Stein?
Sure. Would you please
really? Dr. fucking Stein? Are you kidding? Anyway, this woman's name is Winifred Walker. Okay, what's with the creepy horror danger music? It's broad daylight, the movie just started, and nothing even remotely creepy is happening! If this is this cine-turd's idea of trying to create suspense, consider that mark missed. The only tension they built is in my back for having to sit through this toilet taco. We see Dr. Stein in his lab.
Dr. Stein, a Dr. Winifred Walker is here.
Oh, yes, Dr. Winifred Walker.
Dr. Stein would like to see you in his laboratory.
Wow, this guy's trying so hard, but just comes off as a dollar store Igor. Winifred, it turns out, was a student of Dr. Stein's.
Well, what brings you to California?
Well, I just arrived from New York. My fiance was wounded in Vietnam, and the doctors there wrote and told me he was being transferred to the Veterans Hospital here. He was seriously wounded when a landmine went off under him.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
I've decided to move here to be near him. I've got to help him in whatever way I can.
Thanks for the info, Dr. Exposition. We find out Winifred's fiancé, Eddie, was wounded by a landmine in Vietnam and lost both his arms and legs. Dr. Stein has apparently made breakthroughs in limb replacement, and she comes to him for help. Winifred and Dr. Stein go to see Eddie in the hospital, where he's being treated extremely poorly by an orderly.
Hey, Cal, this ain't no damn hotel.
But my throat's dry.
Tough. Hey, why don't you reach over there and have a nice, cool drink of water? You think I got time to be running upstairs and around and all over just because one of you guys wants special attention? What the hell's so special about you just because you're laying there?
Wow, this guy isn't just a dick, he's a whole bag of dicks.
Service too. I went down there, it's 45 inches, 17 and a quarter, 28 inch waist. I walked down there like this and, you know, night before I was going down for induction.
Oh my God, he's still talking! Is this guy going for an Oscar clip in this backyard made ass fest? Okay, first of all, I don't think I need to point out that the acting in this movie is utterly, diabolically shite. There is absolutely no subplot to this story whatsoever. Just point A to point B to who gives a fuck. And that's the big problem right there. I haven't yet been given any reason to care about any of these people, especially this Dr. Stein, who looks like Christopher Lee and Dick Van Dyke had a butt baby. They transfer Eddie to Dr. Stein's lab, where the doc seems to be hard at work on, I don't know, maybe Bunny Stein? Now that's a movie I'd like to see. As a matter of fact, I'm going to call into this movie right now and suggest exactly that. Oh, and don't need the landline anymore. There's an app for that.
Yes, Malcolm, what is it?
Dr. Stein, this is Grindhouse Guy. I'm reviewing your movie, and I think it would be far more interesting if you made the bunny the monster instead. Let's dump the racist parody angle and go for Frankenmoney. The kids will love it.
This is going to be your first injection of DNA, Eddie.
Injection of DNA? Sounds dirty. At this point, I think they're just counting on the audience to be mental munchkins and are just trying to sound science-y. We meet one of the doc's other patients, a 90-something-year-old woman he's given some kind of de-aging serum. Another patient, a man in the doc's care, is undergoing limb replacement.
Now, Winifred. That's the result of an unsolved RNA injection. Sort of part of the primeval theory, a kind of throwback to the jungle.
Throwback to what? When zebra people roamed the earth? They replace one of Eddie's limbs successfully and decide to go ahead with completing the procedure. In case you're wondering where they're getting all the body parts, keep on wondering. Never explained. Presumably they're donated by the recently deceased, so that's where the Frankenstein aspect comes in, but that alone wouldn't make him akin to the Frankenstein monster. Something must be about to go wrong. Turns out Malcolm, our flea market Igor, has an unrequited crush on Winifred. He messes with the serum the doc is using in the procedure, so it looks like that's why Eddie may be about to go all Karloff on everyone. If you don't know what that means, stop watching my show. They go about completing Eddie's limb replacement. They unknowingly treat him with the wrong serum, then shortly thereafter they say that Eddie should be up and around very soon. They discover... Uh-oh, something is not all right in the kingdom. Their solution is to give him even more of what they don't realize is the wrong serum. And then... Oh God, don't do the stereotypical Frankenstein walk. Don't do it. Yeah, he's doing it. And he's dressed in the same kind of Frankenstein-like suit while lying in bed? Why would they dress him that way just to convalesce and recover from surgery? Eddie, as the monster, I refuse to call the B-word, escapes and ends up in some kind of mill. It was at this point the filmmakers realized there were like 4 people in this movie and the monster needs victims. And although we just saw him at a mill and Eddie is moving at about half the speed of this plot, he's suddenly back at the hospital. Oh, he's gonna kill the mean orderly. Whoa, that actually makes sense. Guess even a blind squirrel finds a nut once in a while. So Eddie disarms the orderly. Shut it. And of course, kills him. There's just kind of greenish goop on him and no actual blood. Was the orderly a Vulcan or something? Eddie then interrupts 2 people in the sack. Eddie attacks and kills them both and also confirms this movie takes place on planet Vulcan because these folks are packing the green blood as well. I have seen some shit movies in my day, which is obvious to anyone who watches this show, but I've never seen one so bad that the filmmakers apparently have no idea what color blood is. Dr. Stein and Winifred keep working as if nothing is wrong, and Eddie didn't turn into a monster, dress himself in a suit, and go on a killing spree. Which, of course, Eddie does again. He gets out of the house unseen and goes on yet another random killing spree. We just saw this! Almost nothing happened between this one and the last one. We see a couple whose date isn't going well, and the woman exits the vehicle, pretty much making her monster bait. Monster bait. Wow, this is an attempt at an actually pretty artistic shot. An attempt. Winifred and the doc still continue as though nothing is wrong until the police show up asking questions about local murders. Yes. Eddie gets out again. How does no one see him or know he's gone? And they're not routinely checking his vitals or even locking the damn doors in this place? And now I present to you the staple of every self-respecting blaxploitation movie, the obligatory nightclub scene. This scene went on for so long I forgot what I was watching. No joke. Eddie shows up and... No effect. Stop right there. The Frankenstein monster was made of pieces of dead people. So he was already dead, which explains why he was able to shrug off gunfire. But Eddie is still alive and a regular guy who just had his limbs replaced by an experiment. So I call first degree bullshittery on him being able to shrug off bullets. And that does it for value menu Igor. Eddie then goes after one of the patients, kills him, and heads downstairs. She screamed, and then he turned around as if to say, "Oops, forgot one." He heads back upstairs, kills her, and heads back downstairs. You know, there's sloppy writing, and then there's this shit. Eddie goes to the lab and starts after Winifred, who begins to talk him down. And then the doc fucks it all up by attacking Eddie. He makes short work of the doc, and then wanders away to attack another random person. Come on, cars never start in horror movies, everybody knows that. The police show up looking for Eddie. Meanwhile, after an extremely long and padded chase scene, Eddie kills this random woman. The police sick the dogs on Eddie and... Okay, I know that the intent here was to show that the dogs tear Eddie up and kill him, but it was shot so fucking poorly, it looked like they just kind of barked him to death. Could shrug off bullets, but dogs are apparently his kryptonite. This movie is the worst of the worst when it comes to blaxploitation parody. So if you're looking for a laugh and don't mind shaving off an IQ point or two, go ahead and watch this experiment in excrement.